our lives, our souls.
Thank you
for the blood that washed us.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Thank you, O God. Luke chapter 8, verse 22. If you don't have a Bible, one is positioned under your seat for you, and or you can look at us on the screen for the text. The Bible says in verse 22, now it happened on a certain day, and he got into a boat with his disciples. And he said to them, let us cross over to the other side of the lake. And they launched out. But as they sailed, he fell asleep. And a windstorm came down on the lake, and they were filling with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we are perishing. Then he arose, rebuked the wind and the raging of the water, and they ceased, and there was a calm. But he said to them, where is your faith? And they were afraid, and they marveled, saying to one another, who can this be? For he commands even the winds and water, and they obey him. And all God's children said, amen and amen. Turn to your neighbor, look in the eye before you sit down and say, good looking.
Good looking.
Today, my pastor wants to talk to you about Jeopardy on the journey with Jesus. Amen. Jeopardy on the journey with Jesus. Beloved, in many ways, life is a journey. And we are all travelers passing through the earth on our way to an eternal destination. In fact, in all of our travels, there is one thing that everybody who's ever been born has in common. And here it is, that we shall all, sometime in our life, experience jeopardy on your journey. Jeopardy is just another way for saying trouble, danger, or calamity. And I've discovered in these 50 plus years of living, there is always some unwanted journey lingering out there on the oceans of life. Can I get a witness right there? In fact, life is a journey, but it's a strange journey. Life is a journey that's hard, beloved. Life is a journey that's tough. And then when you throw a little trouble in there, life's journey seems to produce jeopardy when you least expect it. There's a lesson in the Word of God today, if you don't sleep on me. It's a lesson that will help you to handle the jeopardy on your journey with Jesus. So let's look at three things for our learning today. Number one, let's look at the Jeep of Jesus and the journey. Number two, jeopardy on the journey. And number three, justice on the journey. Are we here? Okay, point number one in verse 22. The Bible says, now it happened. Now that's loaded right there, right? That on a certain day, he got into the boat with his disciples. And he said to them, let us cross over to the other side of the lake. And they launched out. Let me unpack this. Beloved, when you come to this portion of the text, you and I get to see that the disciples, first of all, have been given a divine invitation by Jesus to travel with him across the Sea of Galilee. Here it is. It's a journey that will become symbolic for every Christian who's living on the earth. Are you with me here? The invitation is for you to come and to travel with Jesus. That's called discipleship. Are you listening? The in this text can be pictured as the earth and the sea as the place of time. We've been called to leave or walk from where we were in earth and sail with Jesus across a sea of time. And we are heading into eternity. Can I say some more? This journey that we're on is symbolic to the one in the text, because Jesus said to the disciples, let us pass over.
Over. Amen.
Not with me here.
Yeah.
The sea. Notice he didn't say, let us go under. The text in the invitation is to go over, which implies that when you and I are walking with him in this life, Brother Jesse, and doing life with Christ, we're going to pass over to the other side.
To the other side.
But everybody's going to the other side. But can I tell you, everybody ain't with Jesus. Everybody's on a journey and sailing across the sea of time, but some people don't have Jesus on board the ship of their life. They're not excused from the jeopardy of life. And how worse is it to experience the jeopardy of life then die and go to hell? Instead of having the one on board the ship of your life who can handle the jeopardy as it comes. Can I say some more? Here's all I'm trying to say. Life for the child of God is a journey, beloved, that will be, somebody say will be, filled with trials and tribulations. It's a journey that'll have some unwanted surprises. It's a journey that's filled with twists and turns, sorrows and sadness. It's laced with danger and evil schemes. And the journey sometimes leaves us lost and without direction. This was a level of life. I ran across a story today. It was a missionary couple that had a ministry to minister to pastors from foreign countries. And they were having a conference here in the States, and so they invited a host of pastors to come and attend the conference. And they created a plan that when the pastors got here, they would enable them to take a stipend and go shopping in the small little town where the conference was. But the missionaries understood that foreigners, when they come here, don't always know their way around, and somebody was most inevitably going to get lost. So they gave them a phone number. In the event that you get lost, call this number. And sure, as I'm tall, dark, and handsome, the phone rang. One of the foreigners called the pastor and said, I'm lost and I can't find my way back. The pastor said, go to the nearest corner and tell me what the two cross streets said. The missionary took the phone and went to cross streets, and he looked up and he said, they say, walk and don't walk.
Oh, Lord.
No, mister. The believer's journey is a lot like this, Pastor. See, sometimes on the journey you feel lost. And the location in which you are in does not make sense. But what you have, like this missionary has, is a line of communication to the one who can come find you in the midst of the situation, who can keep the line open until you figure out where this journey has taken you. Can I say some more? Beloved, the benefits of doing life with Jesus is this. Though the disciples were on the journey, they were not expecting this storm to come. And when it came, they had a line of communication open to the one who could not only solve the problem, but speak to them and give them assurance. Yeah. That's what it means to journey with Jesus in this life. Yeah. We looked at Jesus and the journey. Let's look now at jeopardy on the journey. I'm going to spend the most of my time working here this morning. Verse 23, the Bible says, but as they sailed, he fell asleep, I'll tell you, and a wind storm, circle that word, it came down on the lake, and they were filling with water. And, you see that there?
Yeah, yeah.
they were in jeopardy.
Yeah.
Those three kings. Let me work right here. When you come to this portion of the text, the first thing we see is that the master fell asleep. Now Jesus must have been tired from the activities of the day. And this, I'm glad, we get to see, gives us an intimate look, Cochran, at his humanity.
Yeah.
And the fatigue that ministry calls me. Come on, y'all, lean in with me right here. I want to help you. I want to help you on your journey. This tells me that ministry will wear you out.
Yeah.
It's going to happen to you in your life. Raising kids, loving husbands, taking care of wives, working on jobs in the name of the Lord, right? Preaching, teaching, giving, going. It will wear you out. The text allows me to see that even though he was God, he was still a man. And as a man, guess what, Brother Fred? He had the same desires that all men have. A need to sleep and a need to rest. All y'all listening here? Every man need to take a break. No man is Superman in ministry. If you start getting cranky, back away from that thing. You can't keep pushing. You need to take a Sabbath. You need to get a rest. Come on, talk to me. You need to get away. Jesus was tired. He had to get away. Not on the boat. Come on, all right. Take off and say amen to the crew. And slept on the crew. God away. Secondly, we see that while he was sleeping, resting now, while he was resting, somebody say, while he was resting, a windstorm came down. But there's an implication here in the text that suggests this storm was not expected. No, the implication is that this storm came out of nowhere. There it is. The implication is that when they least expected the weather to act up, it acted up. Just for the record, historically, the Sea of Galilee sat in what we call is a basin. Somebody go like that. Come on, do it. Everybody, come on. I want you to get it when you go home to teach this. He was what? A basin. And in the basin, on the east side of the basin, was the snow-capped mountains of Mount Hermon. On the west side of the basin, there were small rocky mountains that had gorges in them. On the west of the west side was the desert. So the hot wind blowing from the west side would pick up velocity over the gorges, pick up speed through the gorges, and then collide with the cold wind from Mount Hermon that was just over the water. And when they came together, they created windstorms.
That's good. It
came out of nowhere. This is interesting. I like this because the gospel writers commenting on this text said, Luke said, Angelus, the storm came down. What about you? Came down. But Mark, writing the same story, said, no, it came up. No, amen. Who's right? It came down, and it came up. And when it came, it created a windstorm. I want to report today that it was both. Are you with me here? I just gave you the geographical landscape to tell you how it happened. The hot winds of the desert came swooping over the gorges, and the snow-capped peaks of Mount Hermon in the cool air came down, and they collided, creating a squall, as the old man would say. Are you with me here? A windstorm. Can I turn it right on? Life for the believer has windstorms. And windstorms, without say amen. Life is filled with the winds of pain, isolation, difficulty, trouble, persecution, mistreatment, confusion, sorrow, sadness. And in addition to this, these storms of life are capable of arising at a moment's notice. I'm not feeling it. I'm a preacher myself, and I got up this morning, sister, and said, "What's wrong?" I said, "I'm sad. I'm filled with sorrow." She said, "Why?" I said, "I don't know. But I just feel it on me." Have you ever been there? Yeah. I mean, just not grieve. I turn on the news and I just turn it off. Every phone call that I get seems to be somebody else going through some form of sadness. Have you been there?
Yes.
And what it is the the winds of this old world blowing against the lives of the disciples. Can I tell you, beloved, we're living right now in the winds of global chaos. Have you ever seen a government so chaotic? You can't even do but one thing before the news cycle turns to something else. Winds of murder, envy, jealousy, racism, rage, greed, idolatry, immorality. Everywhere you turn up, windstorms blowing against you. And if that ain't bad enough, the waves, that's something different. Cut up because the winds are blowing. I feel like working. Don't mind about preaching. Get bad news from home that your wife don't love you no more. Got a new man, and you in a storm. Let's say you go to a meeting with your boss and you find out you got to cut back. Giving you a pink slip and you didn't know nothing was wrong and you in a storm. Let's say your baby calls you for the dope house and they're holding them hostage because they did something they ain't got no business. And you in a storm. I feel like preaching to them. Doctor calls you with urgent news. Looks like you got cancer. And you didn't know you was even sick. And you were a storm. Somebody looking at me right now got money woes. Rent is due. No food in the cupboard. No money in the bank. And you don't know how you gonna make it. And you sitting in church, dressed good, looking good, but baby, you were in a storm. Can you feel me today? The situations of life, these waves that I'm talking about, these circumstances, they can come suddenly. You just get through one something happen and something else arises. You know what I notice about these storms in life, they come without warning. You can't even look at the clouds and tell. Something is about to come down. Wind storms of life come, beloved, when you least expect it. If that wasn't bad enough, this really got me going to ask you. The Bible says that they were filling with water. Now, come on, I was like, hold up, man. The wind was enough. The waves was enough. Now they filling up the boat. Matthew's gospel says this, throw some waves, grow cold. Yeah, or swept over the boat. Mark says that the Gospels broke over the boat. But Luke's narrative, here's where the Greek language can help you, says this, it was written in the imperfect tense, which implies that the waves were both rolling over and breaking inside. They're not contradicting each other. I like what Luke says because he brings most all together. He said, preacher, I was told that the water was filling up. Yeah. Anybody fooled this morning?
Yeah.
With the water of circumstances, the wind's been blowing against you. You got bad news happening in your family. And you thought that you can't take another thing. Come on, y'all, mean it with me. Act like you've been there. Somebody sitting on your rope is dead. They can't take another drop. They can't take no more good news, bad news. They can't take another something happening. Are you with me here? And if it does, they're about to go under. Look at this text. I had to pause for a minute to go back and rewind and listen to some preachers. Dr. E.K. Bailey preaching this Sunday years ago. He said, Wilson, there are three types of storms that affect the disciple on their journey with Jesus. First of all, there's the self-called storm. He said, that's the storm you brought on yourself. You've been smoking all these years, and now you're surprised that your lungs ain't working. You've been dishonest all these years, and surprised that you're lonely in your old age. You're in a self-called storm. God didn't do that. The devil didn't do that. You did that to yourself. Second type of storm is the satanic-called storm. That's the storm that the devil whips up to keep you from walking with God. Are you with me here? That's the one, Jasmine, where he intentionally wants you to quit. Because of your life of obedience. And then there is a third type, and that's the God-called storm. That's the storm that God whips up on you to get you to obey. You know to do what's right, but you, like Jonah, you're going to do you. So God got a storm waiting to get you back on track. There's three kinds of storms. Are you listening here? Now, the beautiful thing about this is that everybody, as I mentioned, is on this journey. And the cool thing is, Dr. Cochran, is that you are either on your way into a storm and don't know it's around the bend, or you right now in the storm, or you on your way out of the storm. But everybody encounters a storm. Are you listening here? What a powerful text. I learned in this passage again that these men would have never took the sea if they'd known there was a storm coming. And as a result, because they didn't know, jeopardy had come after the filling of the boat. The Bible says the boat was filling. Did you see that? And they were in jeopardy. But notice the jeopardy didn't come until it came in their lives. Are you with me? The story is told about a man everybody loved. His name was Uncle Oscar. Yeah. Reverend Zulu, Uncle Oscar was a tough man. Wasn't afraid of nothing except time. Time had come, he could no longer escape it, but he had to travel. He didn't be, and so he took a fight. And everybody was curious about how Uncle Oscar would handle the fight. He landed in town, but then he got to the airport, and they ran up on Oscar. You did it. We're so proud of you. How was the flight? He said, well, it wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. But I tell you what, I never did put all my weight there.
Come on.
I me say it this way. Sometimes on the journey, we forget who it is who is really sustaining the winds and the waves. Are you listening here? And this is exactly where the disciples were on the journey. Fear had them in a headlock. Fear had them in dismay. Fear had the circumstances gripping them so that they believed they were not going to make it. They forgot the divine assignment. Let us pass over to the other side. But fear had them so that they cried out, Master, you won't let us die. That says more. We've looked at the journey with Jesus. We've looked at Jeopardy on the journey. Let me land the plane now, looking at justice on the journey. The text says in verse 24, they cried out, they woke him up, Master, we're perishing. The Bible says, then he arose. You see that there?
Yeah.
And rebuked the wind.
Right, right, right.
And the raging of the water. And they ceased. And there was a calm. Brother, when you come to this portion of the text, we get to see that when Jeopardy came on the journey, they woke up Jesus. Doesn't tell us which one woke him up. Whose idea it was, but all we know is somebody had an idea.
Somebody, yeah.
Somebody. We need to get Jesus up. Or we's gonna die. Have you been there? I gotta get back to church. Or I'm gonna die out here. Come on, talk to me. I'm the only one been there. Secondly, we see that after he arose, watch this, he deals with, look at this, the trouble in their lives. Oh, you should hang on to that. You don't spend time arguing about with him. He deals with the thing, Amy, that's messing with their journey. In other words, justice happened. Why do I say that? Because it's implied that Satan was the author of this storm. And he came to make them quit believing in Jesus. So he whipped up a storm, and Jesus, when he arises, guess what he does? First of all, he rebukes the wind. Y'all in here? And then he rebukes the waves. Let me argue right here. This word rebuke is the same word he uses in Mark when he deals with that man in the church who has a demon. Oh, come on, lean in for me. He uses the same word that he used to deal with the demon who was bothering the man inside of his house. That's how we understand what the nature of this storm was. If it wasn't from Satan, he would just, you know, be cool, ladies. But he rebukes the word, he says, and the Greek word is be muzzled. He slapped the muzzle on the demon in Mark 3, so in Luke 8, he snaps a muzzle on the demonic source trying to cause the storm in the life of his children. That's worth you coming today. I said that's worth you coming today. Not only does he have power and control over all nature, but he's got power and control over the one who wants to destroy your life. Can I say some more?
Yeah,
get this text and lean in with me. I like this because they really didn't know, Father Carla, who they had on board. Which I think I have some suspicions of. That's what a lot of believers are. You have him in your life. You committed to follow him, but you really don't know who he is. That's why when the storm comes, you react the way you do. But when you get to know who he is, storms don't bother you. Yeah, there's water in the boat. Yeah, the wind is blocking it. I don't know how I'm going to get through it. But I know in just a little while, he's going to wake up. The trouble in my life. I feel like preaching in here. Only ship was the creator of the wind and the waves. Only ship was the only one who could make the devil behave. When the Jeopardy came, Except the waves rose up. Now, like then, the waves rose, but so did the just judge. The waves arose, but Jesus arose. Y'all in here? Let me do it again. When they realized they couldn't fight the storm, Jesus was on board the ship. So when you're in a storm, beloved, and things don't look so good, and you're a believer, remember today, Jesus is on board. Brother Dove, I know you got bad news this weekend, but I want to tell you, son, it's going to be all right. Because Jesus is on board. Your faith, he said. cause you to abandon what you believe about God. It'll make you forget who you're doing life with.
Yeah.
And who's on board the ship of your life. That's why I'm glad he let it happen.
Yeah.
Guess that? The storm didn't happen without him knowing. He let it happen. Why? So he could get their attention. Why? He needed them to know who he was.
Yeah.
I want them to change the plane. Now thank you for being so kind. But the disciples answered his question with a question. He said, what's wrong with your faith? And they said, who is this? Not even the wind. And the wind. Obey him. What a theological check among the brethren. Who is this? I want to answer that own question. Can I do it?
Yeah.
Who is this? He's the God man.
Yeah.
Born of a virgin.
Yeah.
Wrapped in swaddling clothes.
Yeah.
Who is this? He's the God man.
Uh-huh.
Who healed the demon possessed.
Right.
And set the captive free.
Yes.
Who is this? He's 100% God.
Uh-huh.
And 100% man.
Yeah.
Who is this?
Yeah,
he's the God man. Who is the express image of the invisible God.
Yeah.
Who is this?
Yeah.
He's the way, the truth, and the life.
Yes, sir.
And no man can come to the Father. But through him.
Amen.
Who is this?
Who is
he's the good shepherd.
Yes.
Who laid down his life.
Yes,
for the sheep.
Yes.
Who is this? The atoning Lamb of God. Who takes away the sin of the world.
Yes.
Who is this? Heaven's hero.
Yes.
Earth's savior.
Uh-huh.
My friend. And grandpa's walking pen. Who is this? The savior of my sins. He died.
Yeah.
Didn't he die?
Yeah.
On a Friday he died.
Yeah.
Nails in his hands. Thorns in his head.
Yeah.
Spear in his side.
Yeah.
He died.
Yeah.
Didn't he die?
Yeah.
For my sins.
Yeah.
Died.
Yeah.
To the earth rocked and riddled.
Yeah.
Like a drunken man.
Died
to the graves popped open in the cemetery. Died to hell got happy. Heaven went into mourning and earth was in disruption. Died, went in the grave and took the sting out of death. Victory over the grave and early, early. This, the author and finisher of our faith. Who is this that loves me that much? He goes before me, heals my body, comforts my mind. Who is this? He's a healer, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Sittanu, Jehovah Shalom. He's all that and some more. My friend, who sticks closer than a brother? Who is this? The conqueror of my storms. He'll get me through whatever hell has to come my way. He'll see me through. I heard he's a good shepherd. And though I walk through the valley where there's a shadow of death, I won't fear no evil. He's with me. His rod and his staff, they comfort me. He's all that. Ain't he all that? I'm closing right here. But I'm glad for the storm I'm in. I'm glad for the trouble in my life. I'm glad the sorrow's on my shoulder. I'm glad because it gives Jesus a chance to refocus me. His ways to me. I feel alright. I came up here burning down, but I'm burdenless now. My hope is in Jesus. My hope is on the land. I'm gonna be alright. If you don't see me no more, it's alright. He's all right. He's all right.